I am highlightofreasonexperts.com. Good evening, at least by the time that you're going to watch this thing, it's probably evening. Today I just wanted to clarify a topic regarding sound design and doing that with Europa in particular. Because I had a few questions about this synth in particular, even while I did a few videos about this in depth, I thought like it would be an additional value just to go through all the different snippets throughout Europa just once more, right? I also clarify a few things over here because I also had a few questions like, how come your Europa patch always looks differently when I load my Europa patch up in my rack? That's handled through here. We have under Edit, Preferences, there's a section over here, General, that's called Low Default Sound in New Devices. I turn that thing off. So if I load up my Europa, it will come up with one single waveform, sine wave, and plays like that, right? The benefit behind this technique in particular is that I can focus on sound design much more easier rather than browsing patches. And this is kind of like the way that Europa internally works. And I'm talking about Europa since 10.1 because it has changed a bit. The first thing that you need to know is you have three different engines. That's 1, 2, and 3. The basic question is like, what does an engine do? Right? It's based on the wavetable. And the way that you could see it is that you have a knob, which is the shape knob, and a wavetable consists of a few different waveforms. And what you are basically making is a blend from one waveform to another waveform. So in this case, Basic Analog has a waveform like a sine wave. And then if I open the shape right here, then it goes to a triangle. And if I go upwards, it goes to a square wave down. And then if I move it further, it goes to a saw wave form. So the basic analog consists sine, triangle, square, saw. But while twisting this knob, I'm making a blend between those four different waveforms in a linear way. So in theory, you can't mix a sine wave with a saw wave using this method. Just trying to explain that bit because it's always a mixture between sine, triangle, square, saw wave, right? It's a linear way. That's the thing that you need to know about this waveform generator in particular. Because if you look out through this list, you have different types of waveforms that basically do the same thing, but they have different characters. Square tone to ramp means you have a square tone, and you go towards a saw wave tone, like this. There you can see the part of the saw wave right there, and if I move it upwards and upwards and upwards, it goes to a saw wave form right there, which is ideal to make a blend between square tone and a saw wave right there. Got that? At some extent, it is similar as using this device, Thor. Because in Thor, you have a similar technique that's called the wavetable oscillator. By turning X-fade on, you get a similar approach. That's a sine wave right there. That's a triangle form right there. And then we have a square tone there. And then we have a saw wave there. Basically works the same way. The difference, however, in Thor, it doesn't really show in the waveform what it's doing. You only hear the sound. But with Europa, you can actually visually see like what's really happening with the waveform internally. Thus, it makes it more ideal to use that as a wavetable oscillator, right? Another thing that has been introduced since version 10.1, that's the user waveform. And this comes with two different versions. You have the user wave and you have the user wave smooth. And the big question is always, like, what is the basic difference between those two different settings? At some extent, you could see the user wave smooth as a smooth version where you smoothly go through the different positions of that waveform. The character from the sound has a more subtle character, So if I take something from the factory sound bank, let's just do that. I will go for voice, go for female voice, we'll go for that one, right? So now I can play different positions from this A. Can I crank up the volume over here? Yes, I can. But while moving through this waveform, you will notice that the way it moves through that waveform is rather smooth. There's rarely any texture taking place. However, if I use this setting in particular, it becomes more like a granular sound. And it also has the tension to become a little bit more gritty while moving through that waveform. So those are the basic differences between the two different settings. In theory, you could do this with, let's say, a drum track even. Setup kind of goes like this. We'll say, Dr. X loop player. I'll just drag in a loop over here. Go for that. And then say copy loop to the track right there. Then I'll select this portion over here. I'll say bounce that thing into place. Then my mic becomes silent. In this case, it becomes a part of my sample library if I select this option over there. Bounce clip to new samples. There we have that, right? So now I can go back to Europa and drag in my bounced version of my Rex loop and throw that inside of Europa. And I'm play with that. Becomes rather weird, right? But that's the whole point. But if you want to play back this original loop as it was, and initially as intended, I could do something like this. I'm going to go through the position up in a linear way and set this up with the tempo synchronized mode. Because this loop currently consists of two bars, I will probably have to go for two bars in total, right there. And then I can tie up the envelope section over there to connect to this waveform, right? So now I'm going gradually through the waveform by turning up this shape knob over there in a linear way. So this is kind of like a creative way to turn a beat into something new, more or less. Then I can also use, for instance, the smooth version instead. If I crank up the tempo, there we go, right? It's the same exact beat as this one, but it has some artifacts on top of the sound itself because of the fact that the wavetable basically moves through this sound in particular. That's the major difference there. So that's one way to make use of a wavetable oscillator, right? But normally you would probably do something like this, reset this device and go for a user wave smooth and then pick a waveform. It works also with CIRM tables. There are a lot of those tables out there. And then go for some wacky sound and throw that in there. And then let's do something creative with this, right? Move that up right there. And then I can use this envelope as a pattern. Over here, there are different presets that I can use for making a envelope, right? So I can just use a, let's go for a sine wave. And then use the sine wave to go through the position of that waveform by cranking open the envelope section over there. So now this waveform as an LFO is being connected to this waveform right there. That's the position knob. And this basically determines the amount of changes that are going to be applied to it, right? So this is an ideal method to make use of existing sounds, but turn it into something new again, right? That's the whole thing there. Let's say I'm going to go for a normal waveform. Go for pulse width. Right there. Ooh, that sounds really loud. Go for pulse width. Right. This pulse width will also go through a setting that's called a modifier. That's located over there. And a modifier is nothing more than reshaping the waveform in a different direction. If I select a modifier over here, you have something that's called full back distortion. I think it would be better to use a sine wave for that. There you can see it. Right there. And it will be kind of similar as using a effect unit like the full back distortion unit that's located over here. That's the good old full back distortion. Kind of works similar, not really the same. Benefit part with this whole setup is that I also have different options to play around with over here to connect a external setting which is inside of Europe itself, like an envelope or an LFO or Flosty or a mod wheel, and connect that directly to the full back amount. So if I do something like this, set the amount all the way to zero, set the mod envelope or turn the modulation wheel amount a little bit around 70%. That's your basic sound wave, right? In this case, it is also connected to the envelope. Okay, over there, I'll get rid of that. Then, if I open up my mod wheel right here, and there's that, right? Because this setting, that's the mod wheel controller, is now connected to the full back amount. So, in theory, you could reshape a waveform in all kinds of different directions using, for instance, mirror or downsample it like that. And it all becomes visually displayed inside of this waveform generator. It's just a matter of figuring out like what these settings are doing, but at some extent, most of them are self-explanatory. That's the thing there. Then we come to this section over here. That's the spectral filter versus the harmonics. And this whole thing touches the additive realm. That's the whole thing there. Because in theory, you can apply a low-pass filter or a LP24 filter and use that to change the partial content of a waveform, right? That's in theory what it does, because it basically reduces the amount of partials that this thing can connect to. That's the realm of additive synthesis. But what's also pretty cool, because we're touching the realm of additive synthesis, we can also reshape our filter using an envelope. Yeah, think about that, right? So if I set this up with this, that's a square wave tone, and then take a little bit resonance amount over there, that defines the amount of partials that I'm going to add to that waveform defined by this pattern here. The rate over here does not have an impact. At least it should not have, because it's just like a wavetable. And this wavetable is now being connected to the spectral filter. This will define the frequency. Yeah, that's loud. Sorry, me bad. This will define the spectral filter. Well, there you can hear that we're touching the additive realm, right? Even better yet, I could go for something like this. Go for a preset and then go for a square wave tone. Then you're going to notice it even better. Because this is something similar as using brick EQing on top of the waveform within Parsec. Yeah, think about that, right? Because it works the same way. Even better yet, I could just do something like this instead. Right here. Add an additional square wave tone over here. Do it like that. There we go. And then do it like that. So this is similar as using brick EQing. And the resonance defines the amount of changes. I have to drop the volume. That's that. So now all of a sudden my Europa becomes an additive synth even. That's the beneficial part there. Can I get my sine wave back? Okay. This goes in conjunction with selecting a user waveform. Well, there is some misconception about what user waveforms is regarding the spectral filter, because some people actually say it's a vocoding technique. It's not, because in theory, we're just touching the realm of additive synthesis. Again, there are some similarities regarding to vocoding and using a waveform as a spectral filter, more or less. But it doesn't really work the same way, because normally a waveform plays back inside of a vocoder. Here it does not, because the waveform defines which partials are going to be active. That's a different story there. I thought I would just clarify that part, but okay. For instance, if I go for a square tone or a sawtooth wave, inside of the ARP section you have different waveforms. That's a beeping noise. We'll drop that inside of the user waveform, and then you can visually see what the spectral content of that waveform is. That's what it's doing. Over here you can see the playback. This is the spectral field of that specific waveform. Those are two different things. Because if I disable the filter over here, it will sound like this. There we are. Apparently this waveform is that small that it does. Apparently this waveform is that small. That it barely listens into like what the shape knob is doing. Okay. But if I take the spectral field over here, it becomes a whole different story. There. Because the waveform itself is being used as adding partials using the resonance knob amount over there. That's the amount, that's the frequency. There. Yeah, now I'm even clipping. But in theory, you could do something similar, what I've done over here, with using an envelope and connect that to, let's say, the movement of this waveform in particular. That can be handled through here. We have envelope 1, 2, 3, 4. I will go for envelope 3. And then we'll select over here preset, and then we'll go for a sine wave. And then use this sine wave to connect to the frequency, that's that number right there, and connect that to the movement of this waveform. Thus, I'm changing constantly the harmonic content of this sound. Almost touching the realm of a PPG. Then I can define like how fast am I going to move that thing around. Then I can define how much of the partials do I want. There. This goes in conjunction with harmonics over here, because harmonics basically does something similar. I will set this thing to LP12. This thing does something similar, but it's in a linear way. That's what harmonics does, because it changes the partials on the waveform itself by setting an amount right there. And then I can change the position. So to some extent, you could see this drop-down list as a additional waveform, but these waveforms are fixed by nature. At least in this case, propeller, but okay, that's a different story. Random gain is nothing more than adding, let's say, white noise on top of a waveform itself, but using partials, right? Let's get rid of this LMO. Change the position, they can see what's going to happen over here. At some extent, it will be similar as using white noise on top of this spectral filter, more or less, because it randomly picks out different partials and they go up and down and up and down and up and down. The big question, however, is how can you make that movement automatically? That can be handled through here. That's the modulation bus matrix, right? We'll set up a waveform that's going to be, let's say, an LMO 1. That's a sine wave pattern. Can set an amount, and then I can define, okay, where I'm going to connect that thing to. Let's connect that thing to the position. All I'm doing is selecting this arrow and keeping holding at the left mouse button, and then I go to the position knob right there, right? So now it starts to move around. So this determines the speed of changes within the waveform itself. There, can I crank this thing open, right there. And this is the amount. So at the same time, I could do something similar. Let's say take an LVO2, that's located over there, and use that to connect to the amount. And then set an amount over here. So now I'm changing both the position of this harmonic gain, and I'm also changing the amount while using LVO2. So now it becomes a rather random partial changing thing. The only thing that will be cool from time to time is using, let's say, an additive synth next to, let's say, a normal synth, right? Like a subtractive synth. How do you deal with that? Well, that can be done like this. You basically take two different waveforms that are based on the same idea. So in this case, I have a user waveform. I can select over here, turn engine 2 on. I'll select over here the same thing. That's going to be user smooth. I'll select user smooth over there. And then I have this signal, that's the second engine, that basically has the drive signal attached to that. It's located over here. And this is going to be the drive signal, right? So now I have a combination of what I want to balance from the drive signal next to the wet signal. That's the partial. So I can still keep the original content right there. So now I can balance between the partial generated sound versus the dry sound, right? This section over here allows me to balance through the different engines that I have. So normally what I would do, especially in terms of making my own sound from the ground up, I would start off with engine 1, balance that and see how that thing sounds like. And when I'm satisfied, I will just mute it and go to the second waveform. Make changes in that. Let's filter that just a little bit. And then go for a third engine. I will go for another saw smooth. I'll disable that one. But in this case, I'm going to drop it off with one octave over there. So now I have three different waveforms playing differently. You can turn it on. That's a combination of everything. In this case, I don't like the idea that a low tone is pretty much up front. Okay, rid of that. And then I can also reshape the movement of that spectral thing. Right there. So that's balancing the whole thing. This kind of brings me to the last section inside of the engine that's located over here. That's the unison. And the unison is nothing more than increasing the voice count and detune that pretty heavy. What I've just done is reset this device. I'll turn on the unison over here. And this defines the voice count. How many voices do I have? This is the blend between the unison sound and the dry sound. So if I take the blend all the way to down, there's no unison at all, right? Now this is the balance knob. Could be seen as dry and wet, right? Then you have the detune amount. That basically makes the thing heavy detuned, more or less. Like you have three different oscillators and the only thing that you do is twist this knob. That's the tune setting, right? So then we have the spread amount. That is the spread amount over the left versus right area. Right there. Okay, if I do it like this, then it becomes one mono. But if I do it like this, it becomes more wide, right? That's the difference there. Then you also have different type of unisons. Normal means that you basically detune that on a tune, on a fine tune setting. Fourth means you're going to detune that with fourth notes, and then fifth is fifth notes, and octave down means you're going to octave the whole thing down with one octave. And then phase only, that's the phase offset between the detuned sounds, right? It doesn't detune it at all, it just creates phase initially phasing or deliberately phasing, right? Makes it really hollow in a way. That's the whole thing with the unison. From an oscillator perspective, I think I've covered most of the basic ideas. This section over here is kind of like self-explanatory because it's basically like effects like phaser, distortion, EQing, delay, and compression and reverb. The only thing that's worth mentioning over here is that you can also swap these around right here. So if I have a reverb first, right there, then I can stick in a delay, right there, and put that next to the reverb, right there. And then I can phase that, but put the phaser in front of everything. Right? And that's doing the phaser after everything. The outcome will be differently because it's defined by the way that you route things. So in this case, it goes through the reverb first, then it goes through the delay, and then goes through the phaser. But if I do it like that, first it will go through the phaser, then it will go through, then it will go through the reverb, and then it will go through the delay state. So yeah, I've been talking about this device for almost 25 minutes now. I think this information would be helpful for those who are still struggling with the idea, like how to make a sound with Europa work. I'm not really touching the realms of ADSR and stuff like those, like the amp section and what you could do to, well, make a pad, because pad. Then I can select an envelope over here and turn that into a pad like this. This is just like basic engineering from a sound designer perspective. Throw it through a filter. Nothing special there, right? You can also change the velocity to the amp. Stuff like that. That's self-explanatory, so I thought I would not really touch that realm. Anyways, hopefully this information is useful. Have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.